Salam aleikum, dear brothers and sisters. We are broadcasting from A9 Studios. We are together with Sister Zeynep, Sister Dilan, and Sister Gizem, and me, Begüm. We will talk about some interesting animals, nanotechnology, mutations, and also some faith-related topics. First, our Sister Gizem will start to talk about some interesting animals.
Yes, I will talk about the divers of the deepest seas, which are known as the beaked whales. We are known as. The scientists have discovered that beaked whales, a species of acetans, which we know little about and the current subject of variety of research, are making deeper and more prolonged dives than any other air-breathing species. And the fact which draws into the most attention of the scientists for this subject, the beaked whales never suffer from decompression. During their deep dives, even there when they search for their food, they always do making deep dives, but they never suffer from the decompression, unlike the people. And the created features of these whales, which renders the immune decompression system, and this sickness has become an important subject for the research in the scientific world. Because there is something we know that it happened to the people all the time. The biggest hazard during the deep dives is the decompression sickness. The most significant danger facing divers of the sea is getting decompression sickness. Because the human body's respiratory system is and the circulatory system are created in accordance with the life on the land, as was ordained by us for our Lord Almighty Allah. And according to this measure determined by the Lord, the ideal air pressure for human life is called 1 atmosphere, and at sea level, this is calculated like approximately 1.03 kilograms centimeter square. Mm-hmm. And however, in the seas and oceans, when you go deeper, this pressure increases 1 atmosphere and for every 10 meters. For example, like the water pressure at depth to 30 meters and is 3 atmospheres, therefore the pressure of the water on every square centimeter is of the diver's body is 3 times more than at the surface.
Yes, when a human dives to 30 meters deep without using any accessories, what happens? Firstly, lung capacity decreases to 1/4, and secondly, blood pressure rises, and also the heart rate increases while body temperature falls. And also there is another change, which is consciousness is negatively affected. We cannot afford this diving deeply.
Yes. And because of this reason that you talked about, diving to a depth of the 30 meters without using an auxiliary equipment is dangerous for the human health. And beaked whales nonetheless make repeated actions and dives to depths like 30 and 80 meters. Normally, they should suffer from the decompression during these dives. But however, because they are using their lungs for breathing. However, there is no risk like that. They have no risk something like this. And they can dive up a depth like the 1,090 meters. They can dive up that depth. But they don't suffer from any decompression or disease. And they can stay 85 minutes under the sea at that depth. And nothing happens to them. MashaAllah. And 1,900 meter is the deepest and the longest dive ever observed among the breathing animals. And this is happened by the beaked whales. Beaked whales have the knowledge of these divers, and when beaked whales swim very slowly towards the sea surface for breathing. And after they record dives, they don't make any sudden or a rapid or an upward movements. They move very slowly. And it helps them to not to suffer decompression. Mm-hmm.
So what is the reason behind the creature's slow ascent towards the surface?
Yes, and there is only one reason for the whales to behave like this. Protection from the decompression, as the primary cause of the decompression sickness, is too rapid ascent to the surface of the sea.
Yes.
Because we know that when people do something, when people go for a dive and they rapidly go to the surface, they possibly have something like decompression. And this is the main reason. They see something and they may have some thing in the sea, or they may get afraid, and when they're trying to escape it, we always see on the news that happens to that people.
Why is ascending slowly from a from a deep dive must nitrogen gas, N2, which is, exists in the atmosphere in the highest proportion, 78% liquefies under high pressure and depending on time, mixes with the bloodstream when inhaled.
Yes, and this gas is not usable live oxygen. Time is needed after a dive of the elimination of this gas to be rebreathing. And in deep levels, gases such as like oxygen and the nitrogen in the air inhaled from the scuba tanks and dispersed at tissues in small volumes because of their high external pressure. And these gases rapidly expand because of the pressure and reduction if the diver ascends rapidly. Because of this reason, divers ascend towards the surface slowly. It's like the 10 meters and the minutes and the speed. The last part of the ascent to 10 to 6 minutes, meters and a minute. And these features that we have talked about, whales, which prevents whales to suffer from decompression.
Yes, and I want to add something here. The lungs of the beaked whales are created suitably for the pressure in the deepest sea. Mm-hmm. Gases like oxygen and nitrogen in the air, which they are, which the whales inhale before they dive in the sea, disperse in the tissues in small volumes during the deep dives. But when the whales are ascending, then these gases expanded in the blood vessels rapidly.
Yes.
So we here see a great system which Allah creates, and this is not happening in the human body. So that's the reason why we have a disease when diving so quickly. Yes. Or ascending so quickly.
Yes, and at this time that you said, the lungs of the whales shrink and prevent the gases, and especially nitrogen gas, from mixed into the bloodstream and thus eliminate of the risk of the decompression. It helps it for this. And this feature of their lungs is without a doubt of a proof of our Almighty Lord Allah. Yes. Allah's creation, mashallah. Therefore, Almighty Lord Allah's creation, power of creation and the art of creation is revealed in the Quran verses. And I'll read one of them. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. He is Allah, the creator, the maker, the giver of form. To him belong the most beautiful names. Everything in the heavens and earth glorifies him. He is the Almighty, the All-Wise. Surah Al-Hajj, verse 24. And so there is a question. As we see that we are comparing the whales and the human here, mm-hmm. when we talk about the decompression. So there is a question, how does the human body react when they are ascending too rapidly? Mm-hmm. Which we know is a decompression. Nitrogen, which resides in the blood of the diver's liquid form, turns into gaseous form because of their rapid pressure change. Mm-hmm. And this is like a foaming soda. When we shake mm-hmm. soda, you know that it's like a foaming mm-hmm. soda. Yes. It makes the same thing
effect,
here.
Yes.
Yes. And so we see that nitrogen molecules turned into a gas come together and cause blockages in the joints and blood vessels and vital organs like the heart and the brain.
Yes, and blockages appeared in the body can result in a great pain, can result in atherosclerosis and lung rupture or mm-hmm. a stroke, which can cause, of course, death.
Yes.
According to the severity of the illness.
Yes, and because of all these reasons that we saw, divers get a very broad education before they start diving.
Yes.
And about the basic diving rules and the precautions against the danger of this decompression. Mm-hmm. They are very important for their health and they have to learn it before they start diving. Beaked whales, however, did not get any training about what to do under the sea. They know these things with the will of Allah. And but they literally know they can suffer from decompression if they make a fast exit from the water. So that's why they are making their moves slowly. Without a doubt, it's impossible that a creature which has no reason and the consciousness can take preventive some measures against decompression or sickness by itself. The one who inspires this creature, this knowledge is our Almighty Lord Allah, mashallah. And in Surah Jatiya, Allah reveals in the Quran, a miraculous features of the living beings should be reflected upon this, and I will read the verse. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. In your own creation and all the creatures he has spread about, there are signs for people of sure faith. Surah Al-Jathiya, verse 4. So we see here, we talked about the beaked veil. All these features and specifics we see, they all undermine Darwin's claims.
Yes. The extraordinary dives of beaked whales, their knowledge of how to prevent decompression sickness like a trained diver, and the special systems of their lungs, all of them, nothing of these systems cannot be explained with the words of Darwin. Let me read the quotation about this subject. I do not see any difficulty in a beaver type gaining suitable features to live more in the water by the way of natural selection and having bigger mouths by the time, and lastly transforming into a giant whale. So he's talking about a myth here. It cannot be obtained, these systems cannot be obtained by chance over time. It cannot transform into a whale over the course of time. It is impossible. It has to be created like this.
What he says, what Darwin says, we see here that it's like a child story.
Yes.
It's like a cartoon to claiming something like this, even something
even
like
child
this.
Cannot believe.
Yes, even child
lie.
Cannot believe something like this. And we see that, like we talked about, no diver can imprint his experiences that he learned in his life about to driving to his genes and thereby provide his, this knowledge to his child or at that moment of the birth. They cannot do something like this. And he needs to teach to this child to this information. And however, the offspring of the baked whales have all the necessary information related to the diving at this at the moment of their birth. Because these creatures did not learn this knowledge as a result of a so-called process, like evolutionary process, something they're so-called. It's true that the mutations which have their invariably harmful results, as we know that there has been no any beneficial mutations has been revealed yet, cannot transform a bear into a whale, much less an expert diver. It's simply impossible that baked whales descended from another creature as Darwin claims, and because baked whales are created by our Lord, our Almighty Lord Allah, with all of these features that we talked about and already present and have continued their existence unchanged for millions of years, and from the time they are first experienced and appeared with the inspiration of our Almighty Lord Allah. And we can see the pictures of the beaked whales on the screen right now. This is the beaked whales that we have talked about. And there is a verse I will read. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. He is the originator of the heavens and the earth, and when he decrees something, he says only be, and it is. Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 117. MashaAllah.
So before passing to the subject of mutations that you talked about, I want to introduce a little fish, but it is very interesting. We will show also its video. This is parrot fish. First, we can start to show the video, the few seconds in the beginning, only the beginning. Later, there is a surprise in this video. We will show it later. Yes, we can start. This is, no voice. This is the parrot fish that I will explain now. Its colors are perfect. We can stop and we will keep the surprise in a few minutes later. These fish play a significant role in bioerosion. During the feeding, this fish greens up the coral rock and then they ingest it. After after they digest the rock, they excrete it as sand. So by this way, they help to create small islands and the sandy beaches of Caribbean. And one, please guess, one parrot fish, how many kilograms can produce in a year, each year? One parrot fish. It is nearly 90 kilogram, 90 kilogram. It produce 90 kilogram of sand each year. And
it produces sand.
Yes, it is producing sand. It is excreting sand after digesting the coral rocks that it grinded. That's why this is very miraculous.
It's like a shredder machine.
Yes, it is very crucial. And there's, let me talk about second miracle in this creature. We can continue on the video. This cute fish, before going to sleep, they excrete mucus from their mouth to form a protective cocoon that envelops and secures them. You see now the cocoon that it produced. And this transparent sleeping bag protects the fish against Mori eels. This is the greatest enemy of parrotfish.
MashaAllah, it's amazing.
It is in the bubble now.
Yes, it is in the transparent sleeping bag that it produced itself. It excrete mucus from its mouth, and this protective cocoon is formed by this way. And Murray eels, which is its biggest enemy, find their prey by using their extraordinary sense of smell. And this is very interesting because thanks to this protective shield, the Murray eels cannot perceive this prey.
Yes.
Our parrotfish.
Because it can not
Yes, because this transparent sleeping bag do not permit the scent to go out. This is very miraculous. How can the fish know that the Murray eel will catch it from its smell?
Yes.
How can it produce a transparent bag which will prevent the smell to go out, which will protect him from its enemy?
And it becomes insmellable.
Yes, it's like you said, insmellable. And another important fact, the Murray eels do not notice even if they strike parrotfish while passing beside it. They do not understand it, even they strike it. And this is very interesting.
It reminds me something like, you know, in Turkey, especially in the hot places in summer, some cities they use mosquito nets. As in Turkish word, it's cibinlik. They use something like this when they're sleeping on the outside.
Yes.
And it's mosquito net protects them from the insects and the other stuff. It reminds me something like that. It makes some sleeping package for itself and protects himself from the being prey from the bigger animals and the bigger fish.
Yes, there are some interesting features of this envelope. This mucus envelope may also act as an early warning system, allowing the parrotfish to flee when it detects predators such as Murray eels, and they disturb the protective membrane. They can understand and they go away. And the mucus has another property. It is antioxidant, and so it serves to repair the bodily damage or repel parasites, and to provide added protection from UV light. And there are miraculous properties, and this is very miraculous that Allah created such a material to protect this cute animal. Such a formation cannot come into being by chance over the time, and it is obvious that such a feature is the result of the creation, glorious creation of Allah.
Yes.
This intelligence belongs not to a fish or any other creature. This is only to Allah, and Allah has created every living things in the world and fashioned all of this.
MashaAllah. And this was Murray fish, right?
It is parrot fish.
Yes, I know.
Its enemy is Murray eels.
Yes, you know, but I know that. I want to confirm it because you know that this little parrot fish have to know that the Murray fish recognize it from its smell, not the way by it looks.
And
it has to know it, and it has to make a precautions for it.
Plan.
But, yes, but it cannot understand it by in time, because once he fails, he would get a prey, he would killed. But he knows it from the first day it has been created by the will of Allah, by the inspiration of Allah.
It is miraculous that it knows which material will interfere with the Murray's sharp sense of smell.
Yes.
It is amazing.
MashaAllah.
Yes, maybe you can explain us about mutations.
You know that evolutionist says that all the living beings come into being in time with mutations. Of course, this is lie. First, what is mutation? Mutation is distortion in genes, breaks, or the other errors, the distortion in genes. And what is genes? Genes is the codes which take part in the DNA. And what is DNA and where is it? DNA is in our nucleus, cell nucleus, but in the bacteria's prokaryotic cells doesn't have nucleus but have DNA. They can have mutations also. So DNA is inside the cell. And where one piece of information present in human genes to be read every second, non-stop, it would take 100 years to complete the process.
Yes.
In a human gene. And I want to show you a film about the mutation. You can understand better now what mutation is.
These necklaces, these intricately looped and coiled strands, are nucleic acids, DNA. This is the DNA double helix, a machine with about 100 billion moving parts called atoms. There are as many atoms in one molecule of DNA as there are stars in a typical galaxy. The sequence of nucleotides, here brightly colored, is all that's passed on from generation to generation. Change the order of the nucleotides, and you change the genetic instructions. DNA must replicate itself with extreme fidelity. The reproduction of a DNA molecule begins by separating the two helices. This is accomplished by an unwinding enzyme. Like some precision tool, this enzyme, shown in blue, breaks the chemical bonds that connect the nucleotides and bind the two helices of DNA together. The enzyme works its way down the molecule, unzipping DNA as it goes. Each helix copies the other, supervised by special enzymes. The organic soup inside the nucleus contains many free nucleotides. The enzyme recognizes an approaching nucleotide and clicks it into place, reproducing another rung in the double helix. When the DNA is replicating in one of your cells, a few dozen nucleotides are added every second. Thousands of these enzymes may be working on a given DNA molecule. When an arriving nucleotide doesn't fit, the enzyme throws it away. We call this proofreading. On the rare occasions of a proofreading error, the wrong nucleotide is attached, and a small random change has been made in the genetic instructions. A mutation has occurred. This enzyme is a pretty small molecule, but it catches nucleotides, it assembles them in the right order, it knows how to proofread, it's responsible in the most fundamental way for the reproduction of every cell and every being on Earth.
Here we saw that there are machines which are replicating the DNA. These machines are proteins. And they make the right decisions and right processes. Unless if they don't do the right processes, mutations occur. And it is very important. And also there was information I want to mention about again in the film. He said that there are as many atoms in one molecule of DNA as there are stars in a typical galaxy. There are too many atoms in a molecule of DNA. And we saw that replications are done by proteins. And also in protein production, that code is needed. So they make their own codes for future their own production. And if that code is wrong, if mutation occurs, then the proteins will be produced in wrong way. And this causes diseases. Evolutionist says that with mutations, a new living beings come into being, or there are beneficial mutations, they said. Of course, this is lie. I want to show you what happens if mutation occurs. I want to mention about some diseases.
And from the video, we also see how the DNA, that the mutation is breaking apart the DNA, right? And not as the evolutionists claim that there is coming a new DNA, a better DNA.
Yes.
No, it is not a better DNA.
You said there is a problem.
Yes, there is a problem. The DNA we have is broken. So there is no more a normal cell, normal normal organ. So it is not a better
there won't be
one.
Normal proteins also.
Yes, yes. It everything is non-normal.
Yes.
So we cannot say that this being is a better. On the contrary, it's worse,
yes.
As you will explain us now.
The mechanism doesn't work. So
there
is no darkness.
It causes irreversible diseases. There is no medicine for that disease. It is very dangerous. Mutations are very dangerous, and I'll show some of the diseases. But the, only the information. I cannot show the pictures of these diseases because many people cannot stand seeing that.
Yes.
Let me show you. Yes. For example, Tay-Sachs disease. What happens if disease occurs because of the mutation? Deterioration of mental and physical abilities occurs. The child becomes blind, deaf, and unable to swallow. That usually occurs before the age of 4. Speech difficulties, psychiatric illness, particularly schizophrenic-like psychosis. This is what mutation causes.
Yes.
And another disease. And this is very well-known disease. Some of the evolutionists says that this is beneficial mutation. This disease is beneficial mutation. They say that this is like you'll see now. I'll read what happens if disease occurs. Life expectancy is shortened. Crisis that causes pain, organ damage, circulatory defect, disorders, and red blood cell disorders of red cell blood production, fever, chest pain, difficulty breathing, stroke, bone infection, leg ulcers, and blindness.
And they are saying these are beneficial, right?
Yes. Yes, they say that sickle cell disease is beneficial. Of
like
course,
they are
why.
Making joke.
It's ridiculous.
There
yes,
is
very
also
ridiculous.
An idiot example, maybe you will explain. Like somebody who is walking. We can talk later.
Okay. And the other disease I want to show. Prader-Willi disease. Excessive sleeping, crossed eyes, speech delay, excessive weight gain, short stature, extreme flexibility, prone to diabetes, easily bruised skin, and small hands. This is what mutations causes. And the other one is neurofibromatosis, tumors, epileptic seizures, hearing loss, headache, balance problems, paralysis, and hemophilia. This is very dangerous disease. It's a disorder that impairs the body's ability to control blood clotting or coagulation. It causes deep internal bleeding, joint damage, brain damage, bleeding to death. It starts to bleed, for example, my hand cut, and it starts to bleed, and
it doesn't stop.
So just because a person die.
Yes, just for a minor cut. It can only die because normally it could get the clots.
And this is happens because of the mutations. This.
And the most dangerous here is that these are not normal disease, as you mentioned. There is no cure for this disease. You cannot make a new DNA in the body and cannot say to the body, you produce from now on a good DNA. Because when it once was broken, it is going like this.
Yes, because it is replicated.
Yes, because
with
it's, as you said, yes. There is no good DNA which to replicate, continue to replicate.
Yes.
So it is not good for our body, not good for the person's body, but on the contrary, it is very dangerous and causes, in most cases, death of the person.
Yes. I want to show you last three diseases. Of course, the researchers calculated that there are about 6,000 genetic disorders which mm-hmm. caused by mutations, 6,000 diseases.
Yes.
And I'm showing just a few of them. The other one is Down syndrome, mental retardation, stunted growth, separation of the abdominal muscles, eyelid crease, low set and rounded ears, short neck, shortened hands, and larger tongue. The other one is?
Yes, it's the general one also, but both Alzheimer's and the Down syndrome, we see it very regularly, and we know how harmful and how bad results it has.
Yes.
It is irreversible diseases. Yes. They cannot be cured. We know Alzheimer's disease, at the end, that person dies.
Yes.
It is very dangerous. Alzheimer's disease causes confusion, irritability, aggression, mood swings, language breakdown, long-term memory loss. Gradually, bodily functions are lost, ultimately leading to death. And Alzheimer's disease, we see regularly, as you said. And the last one I want to mention about is cancer. And it is very regular. We
very
see
common,
everywhere. Yes. And what cancer is, a group of cells display uncontrolled growth, invasion that intrudes upon the destroy adjacent tissues.
So and the cancer is a result of mutations, right?
Yes, cancer is a result of mutations. And also, if mutations were beneficial, it cannot pass to the next generation because gets to the subsequent generation, if it is only in the reproductive organs. Mm-hmm. For example, if a mutation occurs in my eye, it cannot pass to my child because it has to be in the reproductive organ, not the other organs.
Yes.
And also, mutation doesn't add any new information, as you said. And all the scientists, all the evolutionists know that there isn't any beneficial mutation. And I want to show the video of Richard Dawkins, his answer about
the famous video.
Yes, answer Silence. About the beneficial mutation.
And if the case was like this, that every person would like to have a mutation, but the case is not like this. Everybody is afraid of this disease, don't want to have this disease, right?
Yes, I want to show you his answer about the beneficial mutations.
Yes. Can we give an example
of a genetic mutation or an evolutionary process which can be seen to increase the information in the genome?
He's searching the answer on the ceiling.
Yes.
He says shut down the video.
He can think like this all day.
I'm not prepared. He said, can you just turn off the camera?
Yes,
this is his answer to beneficial mutation.
It's so prophetic. We see that how can they agree to degrade themselves like this? Yeah. It's so funny. Doesn't he seem he sees himself like this? It's obviously cannot find any answer. So how can he say that mutations can be beneficial and causes the it is a role in the evolutionary process? It's impossible to claim something like this.
It is scientifically impossible. It means that we break a, for example, plate, and expecting 12 person dinner set with the parts of the plate.
Yes,
it is the same thing.
There is a ridiculous claim of Darwinist about the sickle anemia, sickle cell anemia. That I want to add. The sickle cell anemia. This disease provides a defense against malaria, and this is an advantage, but there's of course lots of
some disadvantages
diseases,
but these are a few of them. There are more disadvantages about sickle cell anemia,
and they say that they describe the mutation that caused this disease as a beneficial one because of this little immunity, and they ignore all the factors that you mentioned, mm-hmm. all the important disease, and they said that this partial immunity is a gift of evolution, so-called evolution, and one could claim that people born blind will not have to drive cars, so they will not die by a traffic accident. This is the same comparison. Yes. And so being born blind could mean, mm-hmm. could be regarded as a genetic gift, according to them. This is so ridiculous. They yes. say that mm-hmm. the immunity of this disease to malaria mm-hmm. is a beneficial
yes.
Side of mutation, but it is so irrational that we understand right. when we compare being blind is not a gift, so it is not either. This is yes. the same logic.
Yes. Yes. And I want to continue with a little bit different mm-hmm. subject. It is also about science, but it is about nanotechnology, which is likely to shape every part of mm-hmm. our life and many industrial sectors in the near future. So what is nano? Nano means dwarf in Greek language, and it means 1 billionth in a metric system of measurements. According to this definition, nanotechnology is a science that deals with nanoparticles, mm-hmm. which have the size of 1,000th of a human hair. So it is a great, so great, great, yes, very little.
Yes.
Just like combining parts and creating a desired shape in a puzzle game, in nanotechnology, individual atoms and molecules are combined in a similar mm-hmm. In a similar fashion to produce a desired product. The concept of nanotechnology first put forward by Norio Taniguchi from Tokyo University in 1974 mm-hmm. are rapidly emerging technologies based on minimizing existing technologies and making them more sensitive. So it is the bigger technology mm-hmm. is minimized in a great number. Generally speaking, nanotechnology is about reducing matter indirectly to the size of an atom, and therefore nano size. In other words, nanotechnology is the name of the technology which deals with production, installation, and usage of materials which has size consisting of 100 millionth and 1 billionth of a meter. So it is hardly
smaller than even our cells.
Yes, it is very hard for a human mind to imagine yes. such size.
Atomic sizes.
Yes. And we cannot see yes. atoms with naked yes. eyes, even with the most advanced technology. It is very hard to be
yes.
Seen. Nanotechnology is a field which aims at the production of instrument which not only can operate but can work efficiently and contains features that not existing in our macro world. By using atoms individually. The highest potential of nanotechnology became known by the law of quantum physics. At this stage, the laws of quantum physics step in and allow for new applications in areas like optics, like electronics, like magnetic storage computing, catalysts, and potentially many other fields as well. Here we can show our yes. video, the one with the longer.
Which, medical or?
No, the other one.
Okay.
So we can see potentially where we can use this nanotechnology.
With the sound?
Yes. in nanotechnology, a measurement unit is called nanometer. 1 billionth nanometer is in every measurement. Every nanometer is consists only of 3 to 5 atoms.
Yes. So it's very small. Nanotechnology is often referred to as general purpose technology, because when nanotechnology is fully realized, it will have an important place in nearly every sectors and every area of society. This will be very useful.
Yes. Better made, longer lasting, cleaner, safer, and smarter products can be used with Allah's permission in the home, in communications, in medicine, transportation, and every area of agriculture and industry. Nanotechnology brings faster, most cost-effective and cleaner systems of production. The means of production can be increased exponentially, so that a few nanofactors can themselves produce billions of products in a couple of weeks. So it is a great advance in technology, yes. And it is given to human by Allah.
Yes, mashallah.
By means of nanotechnology, bacteria-sized mini computers or computers with the size of a sugar cube can calculate power. They are so powerful as billions of computers.
Mashallah.
So billions of computers give information that can be given from a so tiny computer. The things that make nanotechnology potential so tremendous is the structure of the atom and their excellent features of organization with each other. One of the areas in which the uses of the usage of nanotechnology is most potentially promised is medicine. With nanotechnology, it may be possible that robots produced throughout nanotechnology can seek out and find cancer cells and discharge their medicines, playouts into them after entering these cells. So they are
tiny. They are like robots, they are intelligent.
Yes, and they come into the human body, find the cell, and put the medicine in the cell. It is great. Or they can carry out directly surgical operations to open clogged blood vessels. We can show a video about this advance in medicine.
Something 80,000 times smaller than the breadth of a ridge on a fingertip, unlocking a new frontier into cancer research. Nanotechnology, the science of building small, is changing the way we look at cancer. More importantly, the way we look at diagnosis and treatment. Nanotechnology allows researchers to build new tools that are actually smaller than cells, giving them the opportunity to attack cancer at the cellular and genetic level. This technology not only enables health practitioners to detect cancer earlier, but also holds the promise of stopping cancer before it even develops. This revolutionary approach is so precise, doctors will be able to design a unique treatment for an individual's own medical and genetic profile. Based on computer chip technology, diagnostic devices such as nanoarrays are thousands of times more sensitive and accurate than current techniques. Because of their size, multiple lab tests can be done more rapidly and at a much lower cost, using one nanodevice instead of many. Nanoshells can be linked to antibodies that recognize tumor cells. Once they are taken up by the cancer cells, near-infrared light is applied, killing only the tumor and leaving neighboring healthy cells intact. Scientists are engineering nanoparticles, such as dendrimers, to seek out and destroy cancer cells. This amazing technology can be customized for targeted drug delivery, improved imaging, and near real-time confirmation of cancer cell death. Moving research from bench to bedside is an important goal of the National Cancer Institute's Alliance for Nanotechnology in Cancer. A collaborative plan is underway to share research and development information across scientific disciplines and around the world. As biomedical applications of nanotechnology evolve, scientists are ensuring that nano devices are safe for both the body and the environment. The National Cancer Institute is optimistic that through coordinated and responsible development, nanotechnology will dramatically change cancer patient care. The science is at our fingertips.
Nanotechnology experts take as their inspiration living things in the environment and use their features in their works. Mm-hmm. So we here see again that they cannot produce something from themselves.
Yes.
They are looking to the nature, to the creation of Allah, and then reproduce, take it as example. In this respect, viruses are ideal organisms to take an example because of their mobility, conciliation, concealment strategies, and ability to store information and replicate
it. And we saw on the film, the nanotechnology device, I call mm-hmm. device, came onto the cell membrane. And it did. It send its medicine inside mm-hmm. the cell, and it is the thing which viruses do. Actually, it is doing the same thing.
Yes, and nanotechnology, like all other technologies in and advancements around us, is one of the blessings of Allah that gives in service of human beings. And these technologies, these blessings of Allah, makes our lives easier and can be a potential great benefit in every area in the future. Now technology is surely represents an occasion to thank to Allah. When we saw such an advancement in technology, when we saw a new technology around us, as many other blessings of Allah, we must thank Allah for this. The diversity of Almighty Allah's blessing is revealed in one verse in the Quran, like this: I seek refuge in Allah from a cursed Satan, and if you would count Allah's favors, you will not be able to number them. Most surely, Allah is forgiving, merciful. Surat An-Nahl 18.
Yes, and to give an example of the conveniences which nanotechnology may bring to human life in future, let us think a system which money is never used, and let us imagine also a system that instead of credit cards, there is a card developed by nanotechnology and which contains all the information like a person's wages, like recent information about his savings and other documentaries like his driving license, his identity information,
yes,
and passport and the student IDs, etc., gathered into this one card, but in a produced by a nanotechnology. It will be very convenient and very easy for people to use something like this.
Yes.
And I want to change the subject and talk about a magnificent creation of Allah, another creation. This is the pearl.
On Earth, whenever we turn our eyes, we meet a magnificent creation, because Allah created everything in a way that we should take pleasure when we look at them. Pearl has very interesting features besides its outstanding beauty. And let's examine the amazing development phases of the pearl. Now we will show a video, and it is the pearl oyster that produced the pearl firstly. Now let's see the pearl oyster, but we will stop later. This is the pearl oyster. We may stop now. Yes. And when a sand, a pebble, or a harmful plastic organism enters inside the oyster, the oyster engages in a defense mechanism within its body to protect itself. And now we can continue on the video.
Yes.
Yes. We will see now the harmful parasitic organism or a pebble or a sand which enters inside. And now you will see how it protects itself. The oyster begins to secrete a smooth, hard crystalline substance around the intruder in order to protect itself. This substance is calcium carbonate based. It is known as nacre. And this covering process is the first phase of the formation of the pearl. And you will see here the formation of the pearl. We can stop now. So the foreign particles entering the oyster serves as a nucleus for the formation of the pearls. And through the years, the oyster will continue to deposit nacre around it, layer upon layer. Yes. And the pearl occurs. And in the documentary that I saw this video, the lady says that the formation of the pearl is quite accidental. When yes. I heard this phrase, I laughed because it is impossible.
Yes, impossible.
How such a beauty can occur, happen, come into being by accident. It is
yes.
of course
yes.
Created by Allah.
Yes, and I have a question.
Yes.
How is the nacre inside the oyster made?
Yes, there are two main ingredients that form the nacre among the layers of the oyster's inner tissues. In one layer is a mineral called aragonite. In another layer is an adhesive substance known as consiolin. And consiolin holds the aragonite together in the pearl. This is its function. Since aragonite is semi-transparent substance, it gives the pearl a shiny look. The shiny look results from the substance known as aragonite. It is surely thought-provoking that these two substances are produced by the oyster. You saw this is
yes.
just a little being in the inside in the sea between the sands. It is like a chemical factory which produced two substances.
Yes,
miraculous. And it is very interesting that a composition of shell and flesh does not have a brain. It cannot
yes.
make a plan. It cannot know the formula of these substances. It cannot know how it will start the formation of the pearl.
And it has yes. the when we touch the pearl, it has the feeling of like touching a stone.
MashaAllah.
Yes.
It's always called something
it
like
it produces
this. Some kind of stone, actually.
Yes, and
yes.
very beautiful stone.
Yes, yes, and it's the miraculous that these two substances come together and form such a beautiful object, which we use for our accessories. Women have been using this for these for accessories, and such as pearl covering a mere dust particle, because when we look at pearls, it's a very beautiful accessory. It's a very beautiful thing. Women use that on their earrings, like bracelets and a necklace or thing, or whatever we put, it always seems very nice and very beautiful.
And yes. very clean.
Yes,
it is a great miracle to be produced inside something.
Protected inside.
Yes, inside something living, but it's so pure and so beautiful and so shiny. And it is also a great miracle that it comes like this in such a process, because at the beginning it is not like a stone, it is only a sand particle.
Yes. And the pearl that an oyster produces for to protect itself is created as an aesthetic ornament by Allah for us. And Allah draws our attention to the pearl with in the Quran. I want to read a verse, Surah Ar-Rahman, verse 22. From out of them come glistening pearls and coral. This is also mentioned in the Quran. Mm-hmm. And furthermore, the pearl is also mentioned in the Quran as one of the ornaments of the paradise. Maşallah. Let me read Surah Fatir verses 33-35. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. They will enter gardens of Eden, where they will be adorned with gold bracelets and pearls, and where their clothing will be of silk. They will say, praise be to Allah, who has removed all sadness from us. Truly our Lord is ever forgiving, ever thankful. He who has lodged us out of his favor in the abode of permanence, where no weariness or fatigue affects us.
MashaAllah.
MashaAllah. This is just an example of a benediction which will be created mm-hmm. in paradise. Allah shows us only in the world a little example. Yes. We don't know how we will see, inshallah, the pearl in the paradise. Of course, it will be much more beautiful.
And in the hadiths of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I think, as I remember, that it is said that the houses will be made from pearls. Yes. So here the pearl is very precious and very rare thing. Yes. But there will be plenty of pearls, yes. so plenty that the houses will be made from pearls. MashaAllah.
MashaAllah.
May
Allah. We have a cute video here. Yes, what were you saying, sister?
No, I was just praying, may Allah permit us to see paradise.
Yes, inshallah. So we have a Garfield cat.
Yes.
This is a real Garfield.
MashaAllah, it's very cute.
MashaAllah. So we came to the end of our program. We will be together in another program. Thank you very much for watching us. Salam aleikum. Good days.